And I'm glad my kinetic friends are back in the front, right, where we need to be. So good morning to all of you. Yeah, half of my kinetic friends. For those of you who weren't here last night, am I not on? Oh, you need the clicker. We need the clicker. For those of you that weren't here last night, this is my wife, Timmy, and I'm Richie Brower, and we have a ministry called Elijah Now. We have the privilege of traveling around the country and speaking to strengthen marriages and families. And so we've been working to come to East Salem for,
about 18 months.
Quite some time. And something always came up, and it took a while to put it all together, but we're glad to be here, so thank you for welcoming us here into your church, and we had a good time last night and looking forward to our time today. What we're doing today, last night we began by laying the biblical foundation for marriage. What was God up to when he created marriage? We started looking at some of the things that he put in place, and we discovered that according to scriptures, we dig into scripture, we went looking for those bullet points, remember? What did God design marriage to be about? And we discovered that there's only one, and that was that he said, I want you to be one. And so we talked about what does that mean to be one, as the Bible calls us to be in marriage. And we began looking at some things that move us towards being one, and we ended by focusing on leaving, the importance of leaving people, places, and things behind so that we focus on the one prime relationship, human relationship here on earth, and that would be our marriage, right? And so we've talked about leaving. This morning we're going to look at the second piece of that together as we dig in just a little bit. By the way, if you're planning to be with us for the rest of the day, there are workbooks out on the counter out in the lobby, and you're welcome to grab one. If you're only here for Sabbath school and church, not planning to stay for the afternoon, you can write notes on the bulletin or whatever, but if you're planning to be here for the day, please help yourself to a workbook and follow along in that. Why don't we pray, and then we will dig in. Would you lead us this morning?
Heavenly Father, I thank you for Sabbath. I thank you that we can take a break from all the normal worry and bustle and just be still before you. And God, I ask that my heart isn't feeling super still. It's feeling a little harried. So I ask that you will bring it to rest and that you will bring all of our new friends' hearts to rest as well. Jesus, help us to see how to be one with each other as well as be one with you. Thank you, Father. Amen.
Amen. This morning, we're going to talk about why we do what we do and what to do about it. Did you follow that? We lose you in the first sentence. Why do we do the things we do? So let me ask you a question. How many of you, now this is Salem East, right?
I think so.
Am I getting it right? So you guys are into some of these things. So how many of you have ever heard the term self-protection? Yeah, above average is what we would expect. Self-protection. So what is that? The definition is a lot like it sounds. It's being protective of yourself. All right.
And it's not about handguns, just in case you were wondering. We had one person we asked this question a few churches ago say, you know, what do you think when you hear self-protection? He said, handguns.
Yeah.
We're like, no, that's self-defense, and that's not what we're talking about today.
That was a different part of the state of Oregon, where things happen a little differently. So anyway, so basically self-protection comes down to why you do what you do. What are your motives? Let's define it. Self-protection is both an act and a style of relating that is committed to avoiding personal pain. Do we live in a culture committed to avoiding personal pain? Yeah, that's why pharmaceuticals is a multi-billion dollar industry, isn't it? Right? So we are committed as a people to avoiding personal pain. But we go on. Self-protection is a subtle demanding that others come through for us, that our kids don't embarrass us. Well, we can talk about that later. You'll meet my boys. They're awesome. And they, in our home church, let's just say, in our home church, we have had multiple families come to us and say, oh, we just love Children's Story. We can't wait to see what Caleb's going to say. And his mom and dad can, but they enjoy it more than we do sometimes. So self-protection is also asking or wishing that our peers would appreciate all that we do on their behalf. You may have felt that at some point. Now, this is vitally important to our discussion here today because self-protection can undermine even our best attempts at relationship.
We're going to take a moment and see what does that look like in normal day-to-day relationship. Now, I have a friend who has taken quite a few personal hits, and it wasn't anything that she did that was bad or anything. Just, you know, sometimes there are seasons when a lot of things out of your control come in and weigh on you, and this is one of those seasons for her. And I knew that, so I asked her, you know, what can I do to be a good friend to you? I really want to come alongside of you during this time, so what would be helpful? She said, you know, it really takes a lot of emotional energy to reach out during times like this. And so can you, instead of me having to ask you, would you mind just checking in on me and see how, ask how I'm doing and do it like that? And I said, I'd be happy to check in on you. And so I called her regularly. I emailed her regularly. I took a picture, said, we love you, that my son, oldest son and I made, and I emailed it to her so she'd have a visual at work. Man, I worked really, really hard to be a really, really good friend to her. And don't you wish you had really good friends like that when you were in a time of trials?
Yes.
Yes? Oh, thank you. Okay. We need your energy because we didn't sleep last night either. So we need your energy to feed off of.
Please
talk back to us. Well, you know, that kind of friend is really great and all unless you go down to what the deeper motives are. Because I really did, honest to goodness, as pure as I know how to make my motives, I wanted to be a good friend to her. But I also, in the back of my mind, was hoping that if I ever got into a tough situation, she would be there for me, too. Boy, because she owed me. Now, that's not quite so good, is it? And that's what self-protection is. It's that subtle, you owe me, or I need from you, and not just giving from a pure heart. It could be what Isaiah 64 is talking about when it says, all of us have become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous acts are like filthy rags. Mm-hmm. We all shrivel up like a leaf. And like the wind, our sins sweep us away. Because even our best attempts, the purest motives we can muster of ourselves, can still be stained with self-protection and sin.
Now, according to Scripture, the whole of the law is summed up in love the Lord your God with all your heart and soul and mind, and love your neighbors yourself, right? So let's take a look at this. How do we stack up if we broaden our definition of sin to include the ways in which we try to protect ourselves from others hurting us? Now, it's hard to ask, but it's important. How am I doing at passionately loving those that God has entrusted to me or put in my sphere? How am I doing at that? Am I passionately engaging with them, or am I living to play safe?
Really what this comes down to is trust. Are we going to protect ourselves or trust God to work on our behalf? Whether you want to call it the enemy, self-protection, or just plain sin, it is a determined, reliable inclination to figure out a way to do life without a moment-by-moment relationship with the Lord of life. And if you've tried that, and I'm guessing you have because you're human, it doesn't really work very well. So I'm going to read it one more time because it's really important to have this in our heads. It is a determined, reliable inclination to figure out a way to do life without a moment-by-moment relationship with the Lord of life.
Anybody relate to that sentence that she just read to us? Yeah. Yeah, if we're honest, we've done it. We've all done it, haven't we? And you know what? Some of us do it on a regular basis. We might start the day well. We start the day in the Word and have our quiet time with God, and then out the door we go, and we get to the end of the day. I don't know if you've ever done this, but I sure have. Get to the end of the day and go, wow, I handled every single thing I encountered the rest of the day on my own. So I asked God to go with me, but when I ran into challenges and confrontation throughout the day, I just dealt with it. And I neglected to invite God into those individual situations. That's the determined inclination that she was reading about. You know, Part of our story, those of you here last night heard a little bit, and you'll hear more this afternoon, but part of our story is we have spent a lot of time in counseling with Christian counselors. A lot of time. In fact, almost anywhere in the Northwest, if you're in need of a Christian counselor, we can recommend several in your area because we've spent time with so many, and some good ones.
It's not quite that bad. We don't know one in every town. Come on.
Region? Zone? Maybe.
Anyway. We know people who know people in every region, though. So
we
could hook you up. Yeah.
Yep, we could. So we have one counselor in the Spokane area that we really became great friends with. We spent a lot of time with her. And so sometimes she would share, after we'd shared whatever was on our hearts for that day, she would share some things from her own journey. And this one particular day, we had talked about the things that were on our minds, and we were getting ready to leave. Our session was about up. And I remember I think I'd stood up, had my hand on the doorknob, which is when really great therapy happens. Doorknob therapy, we call it. But I had my hand on the doorknob. We're getting ready to walk out. And she says, you know, I had an interesting thing happen this last week. She said, I read a children's storybook by Max Lucado called You Are Special. Any of you ever read that book by Max Lucado? You Are Special. You might remember it if I start describing it. And she said, have you read it? And I hadn't. And so she started saying, well, here's what it's about. You Are Special. Max Lucado wrote a parable about a group of little wooden people called Weemicks. And the Weemicks lived in a little village full of Weemicks at the bottom of the hill. And on top of the hill, there was a house. It was the house of the master toy maker. He had actually made all the Weemicks himself. But the Weemicks, living down their little village, they got involved in what we would probably call today some social networking games, perhaps. And this is how the game went. If you as a Weemick did something particularly witty or clever, if you were particularly good-looking or handsome or athletic, then another Weemick, in admiration of your coolness, might stick a little yellow star on your Weemick self. Now, here's the thing with the star. It could not be covered up. It could not be removed. It was there for everyone to see. So if you were clever, witty, and wise, and you got a star, everyone knew it. But on the other hand, if you were not so clever or attractive or athletic, if you were clumsy or stupid perhaps or slow, another Weemick might come up to you and stick a gray dot on your Weemick self. And like the star, it could not be covered up or removed. And everywhere you went, other Weemicks would go, oh, she got a dot. And then somebody else might give you a dot, and another dot, and another dot. And soon, the Weemicks found themselves living their lives trying to earn stars and avoid dots. Does that sound familiar to anyone here? As she told this story, I felt like someone had taken their hand and opened the zipper to my chest cavity and exposed my soul. Why? Because I realized that like the Weemicks in the parable, I had been living my life to earn stars and avoid dots, even down to my call to pastoral ministry. People I respected a great deal said, oh, you want to be a pastor someday when you grow up. Stars and dots. Why do we do the things we do? To some extent, we all live our lives subconsciously trying to protect ourselves from things that hurt and bring on more of the things that affirm and encourage us.
In the confines of marriage, it could look like this. If I try harder, will you be nicer? If the dishes are done, will you not get angry? If I involve myself with your ministry, will you emotionally stay with me? This gets tricky because peacekeeping is a virtue. But peacekeeping at any cost can be a suppression of truth, not a virtue. In our marriage, I could say that I didn't know any better, and that would be true, but sinning in ignorance is still sin. And if you wonder about that, you can look in Leviticus, because there is a sacrifice that you can bring to the temple in Levitical law if you found yourself in an unintentional sin, because sinning in ignorance is still sin. While appearing to be the dutiful wife, I was really working hard to manage my world and manipulate my husband to meet my needs rather than lovingly confront him and cause disruption in our relationship. I chose passive aggression rather than coming to him in love.
So I'm going to say something now, and some of you may want to argue with me. You're welcome to do that after the session. But if you want to, we can talk about it. I'd be happy to. And here's the statement, and so far, nobody's actually taken me to task on this one, so you could be the first. All of our choices are either motivated by love or self-protection. It's a pretty bold statement. But if you really filter them all down, I'm convinced that all of our choices are either motivated by love or self-protection, including the way we relate to God. Maybe more importantly, the way we relate to God. All of our choices motivated by love or self-protection. Now, self-protection worships at the altar of pain-free living. We talked about that. That's our culture for sure. But love surrenders and worships God and walks with Him through a painful world. Why? Because relationship is painful, isn't it? At some point. How many of you have ever been disappointed by another human being? Yeah, it is. It just happens. Sooner or later, because we're all sinful, human, flawed people, we're going to let each other down, and that creates pain. So relationship is painful. But relationship is also what we were created for. God designed us to be in relationship with one another. He created us to need relationship with each other. And in fact, He's put some really strong messages in His Word about it. And we're going to look at a few of those beginning in Genesis. So if you have your Bibles, open them up. Otherwise, if you can read it, it's on the screen as well.
We're going to start in Genesis 2, verse 18. The Lord God said, "It is not good for the man to be alone. I will make a helper suitable for him." Now, we talked about this a bit last night. We noticed that God pointed out the deficiency, which was the aloneness, but then He also had the solution, which was the helper. Mm-hmm. Now, the Lord God had formed out of the ground all the beasts of the field and all the birds of the air. He brought them to the man to see what he would name them, and whatever the man called each living creature, that was its name. So the man gave names to all the livestock, the birds of the air, and all the beasts of the field, but for Adam, no suitable helper was found. Now, what do they say man's best friend is? A dog. Now, this isn't terribly deep theology, but I think you need it to rouse you a little bit this morning. So, is a dog suitable? Yes, I saw a nod. Awesome. It's true. And I'm just hunching your wife isn't always. If you're like us. Yeah, that's not anything.
Probably usually. We'll give you that.
Sure. Mm-hmm. A dog may be man's best friend, but it's not suitable. And after much thought and reflection, I have figured out why. It's because a dog will never push us to see ourselves in a sinful light, like our spouses do. Nor will they ever push us to seek God, like being in a relationship with our spouse will. Because dogs don't push our buttons like our husbands and children do. And so that's my deep theology of the morning. So, back to Genesis.
Back to Genesis. Now I'm going to... Okay, so we're continuing on here. I'm just looking for it here in my Bible.
About 20-ish.
20-ish. Verse 20-ish. So the man gave names to all the livestock and the birds of the air and all the beasts of the field, but for Adam no suitable helper was found. So here's what God does about this dilemma. So the Lord God caused the man to fall into a deep sleep, and while he was sleeping, he took one of the man's ribs and closed up the place with flesh. Then the Lord God made a woman from the rib he had taken out of the man, and he brought her to the man. The man said, "This is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, for she was taken out of man." That's our slight interpretation on the text anyway. For this reason, Scripture goes on. I've always wondered, why did this verse get in here? These last two are interesting. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother to be united to his wife. Talked about that last night. And they will become one flesh. The man and his wife were both naked, and they felt no shame. Now, Scripture says, for this reason, a man will leave his parents and be united. Or in the King James, it says what? cleave. Cleave. What on earth? He will cleave. We're going to use that word just because it's memorable, right? It's not a word we use in our everyday language, but we're going to talk about that word this morning, cleave. So a man will leave his mother and father and cleave to his wife, and they will become one flesh. So the problem is aloneness with no one suitable in all of creation for a man. And the solution is cleaving or becoming one with the woman that God gave to Adam.
Now this is really cool. We're going to talk about cleaving. And we learned a whole bunch of interesting things about cleaving that may be new to you as well. Cleaving comes from a Hebrew word which means to follow hard after. It has the imagery of pursuit. And this word is only used four different ways in the Old Testament. And we're going to share with you what each of those ways is, whichever the correct use of that word is. Number one, you are to cleave with your spouse, as it's talking about in Genesis 2. Be united or cleave with your wife. Then number two is something that you do with God. Some examples of that are in Deuteronomy. Fear the Lord your God and serve him. Hold fast. If you are an NIV reader and you see united or hold fast, those are often the same word as cleave. So hold fast to him and take your oaths in his name. Or in Deuteronomy 13, it is the Lord your God you must follow, and him you must revere. Keep his commands and obey him. Serve him and hold fast to him.
The third way that this Hebrew word is translated into English is something you shouldn't cleave to, like Psalms 101, verse 3, which says, I will set before my eyes no vile thing. The deeds of faithless men I hate. They will not cling or cleave to me. So something you shouldn't cleave to. And the fourth is what we call a body sense. The tongue cleaved to the roof of their mouths, either in silence or in thirst. Four ways one Hebrew word is translated into the English. Fascinating stuff.
So as we studied, we realized that there are only two things that you should ever cleave to, ever, in all the world. Your spouse and God. And as we said, there's specific things you shouldn't cleave to, and you shouldn't let them cleave to you, but the only two things that you should intentionally hold fast to are your God and your spouse.
Now, we talked a little bit about leaving last night. We spent some time talking about that. And as we leave what's behind, we part ways with those things that are from the past and fully embrace the present. As we leave what's behind, we find that our hearts become available to hold on to our spouse and to hold on to God. It's interesting that even in the English, the use of this word cleave has a double meaning, because we have cleave as in stick like glue, hang on to or pursue hard after, and then we have the kitchen utensil, the cleaver, which is to sever or cut off, right? So even in the English, this one word has a sense of holding on to some things and cutting off others. Does that make sense? So what does this really mean to us? And where was I? Did you move? I'm lost.
I moved your notes.
Help me. It moved, and I'm gone.
Right there.
Okay. So the reason for this is because nothing but God and our spouse should ever be held so tightly. And we are invited by God to sever everything else that would hinder cleaving to our spouse and to our God. That's a pretty tall assignment.
Now, the process of learning to cleave is a very challenging, messy, untidy challenge for us. As with leaving, it's an ongoing challenge to how to do it better and more deeply. Cleaving isn't a one-time event. I mean, it's sort of like, it would be as if us as Christians would be baptized and say, okay, I am now saved, it is all good, I never have to pursue God again. Would we feel that that was a very real conversion experience? No, we wouldn't. And likewise with our spouses, we can't have our vows on our wedding day and say, well, great, the pursuit is over, and now I don't have to cleave anymore. The ring is on, we're good to go. That's not how it works. It's an ongoing process. How do I cleave more deeply? How do I leave more cleanly? And as we seek to pursue more and more.
Now, as God began to work in both of our lives, our marriage was in a pretty tough spot, but as He started working in our lives, we both focused on cleaving to Him, and we found that as we cleaved to God or pursued our relationship with God, we had more in common with each other. And we found that we had more common ground and more patience and more perseverance to traverse the ground that wasn't in common. But at that point, God brought several couples into our lives to help us to see where we weren't choosing to cleave to one another. And those people were a really important part of our journey. We'll talk more about that this afternoon. As we prayed for one another, my mentor began to challenge me to pray for Timmy and ask God to teach me how to love her well. That was a novel concept. Ask God how to love her well. And he challenged me to do that. And I began to pray that prayer. And God started answering and changing my heart and showing me and giving me honest to goodness compassion for this woman that I had married. And things began to happen. As we prayed for each other, we found our hearts softening to the other's perspective. Now, I say that quickly because we don't have time to tell all the stories, and I make it sound easy perhaps, but it wasn't. This was an incredibly difficult season in our marriage, and you'll hear more this afternoon when we share our testimony, just how dark and difficult it really was. This was a time of arduous, hard work. Interspersed with those times, though, was the light of hope that we truly could be one if we stayed on the road. And as we moved through more darkness and difficulty, the light got bigger and brighter, and hope began to be born in us that our marriage might be reclaimed. Maybe it really, honestly could be turned around.
Are you skipping that?
Okay.
Now, as you're thinking about things that you may need to, that may get in the way of cleaving and of your pursuit, it might be your schedule that you're pursuing. Maybe your job you're pursuing ahead of your spouse. Perhaps it's a good book or a TV show or email or the internet or sports or the news or your children. Could it be that we allow our children to take a place in our family relationship that is not theirs? You know, it's interesting. People get uncomfortable when we mention that the marriage relationship should be the preeminent relationship, and there should never be anything come ahead of that, including the kids, and people get a little uncomfortable with that. But the truth is, did you know there's actually research that shows the best thing you can do for your children to raise healthy, well-adjusted kids is to let them know that there's no relationship in the world more important than your connection with their mommy or their daddy. There's great data backing that up. And the Lord knew that from the beginning. That's why He gave us this language the way He did. Now, obviously, we want to focus on our kids, and we believe in raising godly warriors. We're raising boys, so they're warriors. We believe that that's just an incredibly significant and important job. But those relationships can never get ahead or between our relationship as husband and wife. If they do, then they are out of their proper place.
So we are only to cleave to our spouse and to God. So we're going to spend the rest of our time this morning talking about cleaving to God. And then this afternoon we'll be talking about how do we cleave to our spouse.
Okay. I was pastoring when I realized that I still didn't have it. What's it? Well, listen. I didn't have it. That close relationship with Jesus had eluded me through high school and college as a theology major and even at the seminary. Now, I won't say that they weren't talking about it. Maybe I wasn't listening. I just missed it somehow. I didn't catch it. I learned lots of interesting facts, and I loved Jesus as best I knew how, but a daily connection that I could feel, an actual conversation, two-way conversation with God, was missing from my personal experience. And as I started reading some books that I picked up that talked about having this real connection, a real living, vibrant relationship with Jesus, all of a sudden I went, that's it! That's it! What I'd been missing, what I kept feeling like it was just out here somewhere, there was always something, I went, that's it. That's the piece that's been missing in my experience. A real, honest-to-goodness, two-way relationship with God, where I talk and He talks back and we have connection, we have contact with one another. I went, that's it. And as I read these books, I began to do some things differently. Now, the pursuit of God in our culture is not natural, is it? It's not natural for Americans to be still and know that I am God. We live in a culture where we are defined by what we do. We're defined by our productivity. We evaluate and rate one another on how much we get done, how busy we are, how many things we can check off our list, all you list checkers like me, right? So when the Bible says to be still and know that I am God, that is counterintuitive to our culture. There's nothing natural about it. Here's what is natural to us. We intuitively, instinctively realize there is something missing in our lives. We sense a lack. And so we go after all kinds of things to fill that lack. Reminds me of a song, looking for love in all the wrong places, right? And that's exactly what we're doing. I mean, if you look at our culture, just turn on your television for an hour and then go throw it in the garbage, but turn it on for an hour and just flip through the channels and watch what is just flashing across the screen. What are we doing trying to fill that hole? Sex, drugs, money, wealth, prestige, relationships, whatever. All these things, you know, we want to be an American Idol. Whatever it might be. We want to dance with the stars. That would change my life forever. We're looking to fill that void any way we can think of, everything except what would actually fill it, right? Which would be a relationship with God. So we instinctively know that something's missing, but we don't have a clue, naturally, where to go to fill that hole. And that's why God says, would you just stop? Would you just be still? And let me speak into your life, and then you'll know the answer.
We have 6 tips. These are not an all-inclusive list by any stretch of the imagination, but these are 6 things that we have found are really helpful to us as we are seeking to cleave to God. The first one is fasting. How many of you have tried fasting at some point? Did you find it to be really fun? No. Well, this is one that you might be interested in if you haven't ever tried it or if your experience wasn't positive. It's called a Daniel fast. And we do it corporately. Our whole church does it the first 3 weeks of January. And obviously, we're not going without any food for 3 weeks, so none of us would be here to have a church. But what it is when Daniel heard what was going on in Israel, his heart was just weighed down, and he fasted and prayed before the Lord about what his response to that should be. And what he fasted from, he had no wine, no meat, and no pleasant food. Richie has thoughts about this. And how our church has chosen to interpret that is we drink only water and then no processed foods, because let's face it, processed foods are so pleasant. So we avoid those and basically have a vegan diet with very little help to make the meal prep faster. That's spoken from the woman who's trying to cook. Yeah. But this fast has been amazing for our church. We have had people's health completely turn around. We've had people who were having really big money challenges and financial challenges turn a corner. We had one person's business who was just sinking down, 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 and by the end of the fast, it started climbing and now is extremely
prosperous,
yes. My experience with this is 2 years ago, our pastor encouraged us to write down the things that we wanted to fast over and bring them before God and in prayer. And so, like a very dutiful little student, I wrote down my 3 things, and I prayed about them, and I was so excited because they were very, very noble, very, very God-honoring, and I knew that God was going to listen to my fast. And so we fasted religiously that time, and 3 weeks, and we were very, like I said, we were religious about it. And at the end, God had not touched any of my 3 things I had brought before him, and I was not a happy camper. And a few months later, I was talking to my mentor about it, saying, you know, our pastor said, and I know you've said too, that God really meets us when we reach out to him like this. And that's just not been my experience, and I'm not really happy about it. And she kind of cocked her head, and her eyes got just a hair wider, and one eyebrow slightly lifted. And she said, it really seems to me like you were trying to manipulate God through your choices. I said, yes, it would appear that way, wouldn't it? And she's like, Timmy, Fasting is not about you getting your list, no matter how noble it is. The purpose of fasting is so it registers in your soul that you need nothing more than you need Christ. Food and water are nothing compared to your thirst in your soul. And she's like, so what do you think might be an appropriate response to the insight you have just had? I said, I think we should probably pray and I should probably repent. She went, I think that's a great idea. So right then we prayed and I repented of the direction my heart had been going in my fast. And what was really interesting is shortly thereafter, God started moving powerfully on my list. Because it really was a good list. There was nothing bad in it. But God had a more important purpose than my list, and that was to show me the state of my heart. Even as I came to him, what I thought was fairly purely, he wanted me to see that it really wasn't nearly as pure as I thought it was. So, fasting, if you haven't ever tried it, would encourage you to do it. But don't do it to get your own way, because you'll be disappointed. Number two is journaling. Why don't you just do that
one? Can we do this one?
Yep.
Okay. I don't know what it is about journaling, guys. But for some reason, most guys are not into journaling. We think it's a girl thing. I think it's because, you know, when we were younger, girls kept those diaries, and we didn't do that. But I just want to tell you, several years ago, I started a journal, and it has been a powerful, powerful tool for connecting my heart to the heart of God. And we'll tell you a little more about how I use it. But this is my second one. These have become... like altars from days gone by where we write down the ways that God is leading in our lives, and when we hit a bump or a dark spot, we'll go back to the journal and say, why are we here again? And open it up, and this is where we record the direction that God has given us, verses he put on our hearts, words that he spoke to us, and time again, we have found hope and encouragement going back to our journal and saying, what was it God told us that put us on this path to begin with? This is a powerful tool, a monument of my walk, my relationship with God. And I'll tell you, it's not just me. Last summer, some families, some of our dear friends, we went on a camping trip together, just our families and our kids. And on Sabbath afternoon, three of us dads went for a hike. And one of the dads, one of my good friends, his health is not great. He has a kid who's, 9 years old, somewhere in there. But his health is somewhat precarious. And we got talking as we were walking about some pretty deep spiritual things, and he brought up the fact that he journals. And he turned rather sober as we were hiking along. He said, one of the reasons that I keep a journal is because if anything should ever happen to me, I want my daughter to have a record of my spiritual legacy. I want her to be able to read through my journals and experience firsthand my experience with God. If something should happen to me, that is something I want to leave to her as a gift. Journaling is a powerful, powerful tool. And those of you who are kinesthetic, journaling is awesome because when you're praying, that's when your hand keeps moving. I used to fall asleep in my prayers all the time. And I'd struggle and struggle and struggle until somebody said, try journaling. It was amazing. Just keeping my hand moving there and writing my prayers out transformed that part of my time with God. So journaling, powerful tool.
Number three, read or listen your Bible through. The Bible was originally intended as an oral tradition. That's how, when Moses came down from Mount Sinai, he didn't hand out pamphlets to everyone. He stood and he spoke the words of God to the people. And there is something really powerful when we just take in large chunks of scripture in the way that it was intended, whether it be reading it or listening to it, so that we can get not just the proof text so we can prove that we're right, but so we can really hear the heart of God. If our purpose is to cleave to God and to get closer to him, to have a long conversation as he is just pouring his heart out to us is a very powerful tool. So if you're more of a proof texter or going through your Sabbath school lesson, that's great. Don't stop, but include this as well. An audio Bible might be a really good thing for you if you have a long car drive at any point in your week, if you're commuting, or if you have One thing I've thought about starting, and I haven't done it, I thought about it just this last weekend actually, is like when I'm making dinner at night to have it on, and who knows, the kids might even get some of it into their heads as well, another added bonus. But to have that kind of renewing of our mind on who Christ's character is so that we can want to get closer to him in that.
Number four, Noah days. How many of you have ever heard of a guy named Enoch? What do we know about Enoch? What does the Bible say of Enoch? He walked with God. So some people talk about Enoch time, but you know there's another person in the Old Testament that the Bible says also walked with God. His name was Noah. And I think Noah might be even more apropos for us and where we live in Earth's history. But Noah walked with God. What you call it doesn't really matter. But what this is a tool for helping us slow down and spend some time with God in a way that most I had not experienced, at least. I began a tradition, and I try to do this once a month. I take part of a day, it's usually about a half a day. I take my journal and my Bible. I take a water bottle and food, because I like food. And I put all those in my little day pack, and I go out into the woods. We have a wildlife preserve not far from our house, and so I'll drive to this county park and hike through the park and into the wildlife preserve. I've got a big boulder. It's my rock. I sit on my rock and I look out across this beautiful lake, and the geese and the deer and all the animals are going around me. And I sit on that rock and I pull out my Bible and I say, Lord, what would you have me read? And I wait until God directs me where to read in his word. And then I open my Bible and I begin to read the chapter that he directs me to. And as I'm reading that chapter, I have my ear, the ear of my mind, tuned, asking the question, Lord, what are you saying to me through this passage? What part of this passage applies to my life, the things I'm experiencing? And it always does. And when I come across parts that apply, I underline them. And when I finish reading, usually a chapter there, then I open my journal. And if I were to walk around the room, I could show you these journal entries here. Here's probably my last one. I'll see if I can find it. Yep, there it is. South Baldy Lookout Station on top of this mountain. I drove to the top of a mountain, and from the top of the mountain where I was sitting when I wrote this, I could look into Idaho, Canada, and eastern Washington. Amen. Amen. It was God's country up there, me and the grizzly bears. Good stuff. So that particular day, God directed me to Romans chapter 6. And there were several verses in Romans 6 that jumped out at me. And so when I had finished reading through the chapter, I hand wrote them into my journal and I wrote notes about what they meant to me, what God was saying to me through those. And when I finish my time in Scripture, then I keep my journal open and I will write into my journal, Lord, is there anything else you'd like to say to me? And I wait and I listen. For those of you who weren't here last night, I don't hear audible voices, okay, in case you're wondering if I escaped from somewhere recently. I don't hear audible voices, but God speaks very plainly to my mind. I believe he's speaking to all of our minds. And if you'd like, I can share some quotes that have given me that belief. But he speaks to my mind, and I write those things in. Sometimes he speaks about our family. Sometimes he speaks about our ministry. Sometimes he speaks about an area that I need to grow. My character needs to be developed, or habits that need to be formed or broken, depending on what he's interested in. He may talk to me about our boys, teaching me things I need to know to help be a good dad. One time, I said, God, we need to change our family schedule. This isn't working. And he went, try this. And I wrote it all out, and I came home, and I showed Timmy. She went, yeah, I think that'll work. And boom, there we were. So we have these conversations, and then after I've asked God, what would you say to me? Then I have a few questions of my own I'd like to ask. How many of you have a few questions you'd like to ask God if you thought he'd answer? Well, I do too. And so I ask my questions, and you know what? More often than not, he answers. It's a two-way conversation. How many of you believe in having a relationship with God? How many of you would be satisfied having a human relationship where you did all the talking? Now, some of you might think that was your perfect world. Why is it that we think it's okay and we'll call it a relationship with God when it's something we'd never be okay with another human being? What is happening with us? Why on earth would we think that was okay or even healthy? God is in the business of talking to his kids. We have instance after instance after instance throughout Scripture. And yet somehow in our culture, we kind of think he likely quit several hundred years ago. For sure he quit when he was done with Ellen White. He's not talking to anybody since. But that's not what Scripture says. God wants a two-way relationship with each of us. And this is one of the ways that I get to experience that, taking that Enoch time.
Number 5, slow your pace. How many of you have tried really hard to slow your pace? You know, so you have time for God. We've been very wholly unsuccessful about this. We have worked very hard to slow our pace, and then a whole bunch of really, really great, important things come in the place of the things we took out. There's a book called Good to Great, written by Jim Collins. Mm-hmm. And the first line of it, while it's being applied to the business world, is very appropriate for our Christian world as well, and that is, good is the enemy of great. God wants to do great things in you, through you. He wants to do great things in your church. But if you are so bogged down by the trillions of good things that you're doing, there isn't room for the great things that he wants to do. And he can't communicate those to us unless we slow our pace. And I think that's going to be an ongoing thing for all of us forever until Jesus comes. Because it's just relentless, this pace that we both feel internally as well as externally motivated to keep up. But we must slow our pace if we're going to cleave to God and have that tight two-way relationship.
Number 6, here's one that might be a new idea. We're talking about ways to strengthen your connection with God. Number 6 is tell your story. Revelation says of the saints, they overcame him, speaking of the dragon, by the blood of the Lamb and what? The word of their testimonies. Now I've got a quiz question for you. How many of you have ever heard a sermon preached about overcoming by the blood of the Lamb? You're kidding me. Do we not talk about overcoming by the blood of the Lamb in the Seventh-day Adventist Church? Wow, I've been asking the wrong question. Now, how many of you have ever heard a sermon about overcoming by telling your story? Even less. I'm amazed. Now, here's the truth. We've traveled around the country sharing this message, and I ask this question everywhere we go, and almost without fail, regardless of the size of the audience, there's never been more than 3 people raise their hands and say that they've ever heard a message about overcoming through sharing their testimony. But Revelation is clear. 2 parts to overcoming the enemy in the end days. 1 is the blood of the Lamb. Are we grateful for what Jesus did on Calvary? Absolutely. You guys, I mean, the cross is right here in the front of your sanctuary for a purpose, right? It's not just filling a spot in the corner on the stage. It's because we are eternally grateful for what Jesus did for us at Calvary. And it's through his death and resurrection, through the power of his blood, we overcome sin. We're not stuck where God finds us. Hallelujah. Is anybody grateful for that? But that's not the whole story. Revelation says we overcome our enemy, the devil, by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. You want to grow closer to God? Share with others what he's done in your life. Now, I grew up in a Seventh-day Adventist. Some of you may not have come from that culture. That's fine. We're glad you're here. But I grew up in that culture, which means I went to church school, a church high school. I went to Adventist college and master's program. But when I was in high school, we would do what we called Week of Prayer. Any of you remember this? Week of Prayer. Week of Prayer. It was the time when we brought in people, and it seemed like when I was in academy anyway, the stories always went the same. They would share their testimony, and it went something like this. You know, I was raised in a good Christian home, and then somewhere along the line, I got into drugs and sex and rock and roll, and it was... And then God got a hold of me and saved my life. Praise the Lord. I'm so glad to be a Christian. And I would sit there and listen to these stories as a teenager and think to myself, man, I guess I'm going to have to go out and rebel so I can have a testimony to share. Have you ever think that, or is it just me? I have a strange mind. It's okay, I got a couple. All right. Now, but the truth is, I didn't understand a few things. We're all sinful, right? We're all fallen. We may have taken different paths. You know, some of us may have looked good our whole lives and been incredibly prideful and smug in our sinfulness, right? We were the churchy sinners. And then there's others that, you know, they just say, nah, let's just go out and do it.
Truth is, we've all got a story. Has God done something in your life? Has he saved you from your temper? Has he given you the grace to raise a child that pushed all your buttons? Has he helped you maybe this morning, getting ready for church, to swallow some words that were about to come out that would not have been helpful, loving, or kind? If any of those things that happened in your story, or a million other options, did he help you hold your tongue as you were leaving church last weekend when that rascal cut you off as you were pulling out of the church parking lot? That's usually where we lose our Christian experience on Sabbath morning, by the way. We exit the parking lot and instantly we're back in the world in more ways than one. But we have stories to tell. Is God alive in this church? Yes? Then you have stories to tell. And guess what happens? When you tell the stories of how God has moved in your home, in your marriage, in your business, in your life, in your health, whatever it may be, your finances, you grow closer to God. You ever notice what happens when you have a car, maybe you've had a car for a while, and you start to just kind of feel like, yeah, you know, it's all right, it's a car. It's a car. It's a good car, I guess. It gets us from point A to point B. But then one day, it's a sunny day, and you go outside, and you take out the hose, and get the soap, and you wash the car. And then you get the Armor All, and you shine the tires and the dash, and you wipe it down inside out, and you vacuum it, and you get the wax, and you buff it, and when you're done, it shines, and you step back, and you go, wow, that's a good-looking car. There's something about investing in something that increases our affection for it. Does that make sense? It's true in relationships with people and with God. When we tell the stories of how God moves in our lives, it warms our heart towards Him, and we grow closer to Him.
That's our list of things that we have found as we looked back, because one of the parts of our story is as we look at our story, we were pastoring, and then we quit pastoring and got converted, and then we moved on from there. And it wasn't that we weren't doing the best we knew how in the churchy ways that we did them. It was that we were missing the power of God to do the things that we needed to be done. And those are things, as we looked back, were really meaningful to us to help us cleave to God. And as we go closer to God, the first person to experience the fruit of that really should be our spouses. God will soften our hearts towards them. Because when God begins to convert our marriage, a transition takes place as we move away from our self-protective thoughts and behaviors and start focusing on our spouse and on God. We stop focusing on just ourselves and our needs, and we begin to cleave or pursue hard after both God as well as our partner. And as we said before, it's not an event. It's a very messy process. But as our hearts are converted, our marriages are transformed into something much more beautiful than what we could manage on our own power. In our last session this afternoon, we're going to talk about 10 specific tips, practical ways that you can cleave to your spouse. And unfortunately, they're very cheap, and there's no Caribbean cruise on that list. That saddens me. It really does sadden me, because I'm very sure that a Caribbean cruise would significantly help our cleaving. Thank you. Amen. Exactly. But this list is a very inexpensive list. You can do it with items you have at home, so to speak. But we're going to close with a story on what is the fruit of cleaving to God.
Several summers ago, after we had begun the journey of turning a corner and God had begun healing our marriage, I got the best Father's Day card I have ever received. It's on the screen. Timmy created this card for me, and it was an outstanding card. Now, I need to give you a little... Well, let me read the card to you first here, if I can. Huh?
Do you want to give the background? I'll see if I can.
I'll give the background. Timmy will see if we can get a legible copy. It's not... I didn't bring it with us, if that's what you're looking for.
No, I know you didn't.
Okay. We were living, at the time she gave me this card, we were living in a 574 square foot, one bedroom bungalow, we call it. You might call it a cabin. We call it the bungalow. There was Timmy and Richie and Caleb, three of us in 574 square feet, and Timmy was large with child. Number four was on the way. Now, I had been unemployed. We'd stepped out of our role as a pastoral couple. I had been unemployed for quite some time. I'd applied for all kinds of jobs. I'd applied to be one of those guys that goes around filling the peanut vending machines and couldn't get a job doing that even. You name it, I applied for it. I worked at summer camp for 17 years, including being the camp director. I saw an opening for a camp director's secretary. I thought, well, if I've been the director, I can probably be the secretary to a director. I couldn't even get an interview. So that's kind of how it had been. So here we are, living in this tiny little space, no income to speak of, and right across the driveway from the little bungalow we're in is our dream home. Timmy had drawn the plans herself. We had built it with our own hands, but we were building out a pocket, and when I stepped out of my role as a pastor, the pocket dried up, and the building stopped. So there it was, all dried in. There was the shell of a house, but there was no insulation, no running water, no drywall, no carpet, no nothing, just a shell. And so Timmy's large with child, and ladies, those of you that have had children, you remember that nesting instinct? You get there in that third trimester, you want everything to be perfect before the baby arrives, remember that? Well, she's going through that, and here we are, stuck in this tiny little one-bedroom bungalow with a loft, trying to figure out where number four is going to fit. And in that situation, she wrote me this card, and it said, walk up on the stage where you can read it. It's hard to find a guy, so what a dad, it's hard to find a guy that is good at so many things and loves us well too. We are, I'm not going to be able to read this to you.
Do you want me to try?
Yeah, if you can read
We are blessed to have you as our house bander. I wouldn't trade you for anything. I'm glad you have been unemployed.
Think about that, ladies. She's glad I'd been unemployed.
I'm glad you stayed in this uncomfortable place so that we could love better. I am glad you are the father of my children. I am glad God gave me you before I even knew I needed you.
For the first time.
Yes, for the first time I can honestly say that if I could do it all again, I would choose you. That's miracle talk. Thank you for being my honorable man. I need you. I want you. I love you. I respect you. Happy Father's Day.
Not bad, huh, guys? Now, can you ladies even imagine writing that kind of card when you're living in those kind of circumstances?
What prompted this card is that Richie had offered to go over to the big house, as we call it, and draw me a bath. Which was no small feat because, as he said, there was no electricity, there was no water, and there was construction dirt and goo and dust all through my beautiful jetted tub that I had never used. And I just want to put in a side note. When we were pastoring, we took a spiritual gifts inventory. Our whole church did. And Richie scored a zero on compassion. Nothing. And so when he offered to draw me a bath, I was kind of taken aback, because that's not something my zero compassion score husband is likely to do. And I said, well, sure, if you want to. And so he went about cleaning up the tub, and he ran a power cord so I could have jets and classical music. And then he took 5-gallon buckets that he filled in our shower, and then he walked across the driveway and dumped them in my tub. And then he went back over and he filled them up, and then he went back and dumped them in my tub. It probably took him 2 hours or more to draw me a bath. And I was amazed, honestly, to the place of tears and writing this Father's Day card, that God was big enough to take my zero compassion score husband and give him a tender heart. I didn't know God was that big, but he is. Because when we cleave to him and when we move towards him, he does amazing things with stubborn people, and he's not the only stubborn one in our home, just in case you're wondering. And I was opened up to God in a way I never had been previously because of Richie's cleaving to God, which gave me a desire to cleave to God more myself. Because if God can do that to him, I wonder what he can do with me. And it was good and it was powerful, and that's why this card was written.
Now, focusing our attention on our walk with God, just as we wrap up,
is not a formula for the good life. In fact, as our enemy sees us moving that direction, he's going to ramp up his efforts to dissuade us. But here's what can happen. Who we are and how we relate to the struggles that will come our way can be vastly different. And that is the power of the gospel working in us. And that is the fruit of a converted marriage. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you so much for the time to open your word again and to think about how we're doing at pursuing our relationship with you and with the spouse that you've given us. Lord, we just pray that you will speak to our hearts, make us tender to your word, to your prompting, to your direction. And God, as we move now into the next phase of our worship time together, we invite your presence to be here with us in a powerful way. Amen. Thank you all.